what's it? What?
Some.
I look like a bottle of lard. Not you.
Microwave, and then to...
Webster.
Good morning. The prime target this morning is Bill Vander Zalm, Minister of Municipal Affairs and the man in charge of Transpo and Transit. Maybe we can get some straight-up answers from him on these particular questions. You never know with the provincial cabinet minister. But Vander Zalm has a habit occasionally of being blunt and coming to the point. And one of the points I want to get to is the Clearbrook Mobile Home Housing Estate out in Matsqui. I remember Wyatt was out there the other day, my reporter Steve, and we find that there are 25 people who have bought mobile homes at about $62,000 a piece, $62,000 a piece, were advised to move their mobile homes into them for occupancy several months ago, and then along comes Matsqui Municipality and bans occupancy. And these unfortunate people are sitting on the outside, money in the mobile homes. Matsqui says this, can't get hold of the developer, Larco Development, to give me his side of the story, and God knows we've tried. So we've got Bill Vander Zalm to try and help us. Another thing that I want to have a go at with Bill Vander Zalm is the Lillian Mann case in Burnaby. She first came to me, and I sent her to the news hour as a breaking story. Lillian Mann is the woman for whom Bill Vander Zalm says he has some particular sympathy, but who has been put through by what is agreed are the archaic expropriation procedures of the province of British Columbia, which everyone has known have been archaic for 50 years. And then, for a lighter note this morning, I've got a hatchet man from Stevenson and Kellogg, a relocation counselor. He's a guy who comes in at the behest of a big company and says, you're fired. You've got the axe. You're for the off. And they made a film about it. You'll see one cheery little clip right now about after the axe.
Security reasons and company policy, it will be appropriate for you to give to either me or Mr. Anderson down the hall, the director of personnel, your keys and any credit cards that you may have.
What, now or later?
Well, it doesn't matter. If it's convenient for you, I'll be happy to take them. Thank you.
I know.
Sorry to have to ask for them, but I might just suggest to you that it's very much in your interest to leave the company this afternoon in a very professional manner.
Come on, that's all right, it's all right. I know how to behave myself.
Okay.
You'll obviously gather that the man in that little clip from this National Film Board thing is not a union member. You can't fire union members, certainly not a member of the BCGEU. He's middle management. He's out in the cold. I don't know if this is an exercise in PR or if big companies actually take an interest in people they chop. And then just for some blood and gore, fortunately not human blood and gore this morning, we've got my old colleague and buddy, the outdoorsman par excellence. That's French, Bill, par excellence. You don't mind me using the French. And his name is Mike Cramond. And he's got a bestseller going on killer bears. And I'll tell you my story about bears when I interview Mike Cramond towards the end of the show. But first, we're going to have attendez-vous, s'il vous plaît, monsieur.
Oui.
Vander Zalm, after the break. The Webster people have been trying to get hold of the principal of Larco Developments now for some time. We can't get them to give their side of the story. Just briefly, Mr. Vander Zalm, I think you've been filled in a little bit. There are 124 pads on this site in Matsqui. There are 24 occupied. The municipality has said, no, you can't occupy the ones that are in because they say they might dip and dive. And because they haven't seen the municipal officials say they haven't got the details of the engineering on the land use contract. But I'm concerned about the people that came to me and the housing shortage. Matsqui says, no, you can't go in. Nobody knows when they're going to get in. Try to get hold of Chabot, but he's, like most of your colleagues, traveling somewhere in the world today. What can you do to help these people, to get them into the homes or to get something done for them while the developer apparently is fighting with Matsqui Municipality?
Well, obviously, we need to look at the consumer legislation as it affects the sale of mobile homes, because a lot of these people have been sold a mobile home at a premium price with the promise that they could get into a spot.
Now, however, I don't blame the man who sold the mobile homes, because they didn't guarantee a spot. They recommended this spot, presumably, but they merely delivered on instructions. And as far as I'm concerned, they're clean.
Okay, they obviously didn't, in the contract, specify a time. And Larco had promised that the facility would be ready mid-summer.
Right.
And that didn't come about. They're at the base of two hills. And there is an engineering problem. The Matsqui engineers have asked for the as per constructed plan so that they can in fact check it out to see if Larco complied with the land use contract before the people actually get in there and find that there are certain problems. So I think it's nearing a conclusion, but in the meantime, I'm meeting with the Minister of Consumer Affairs this afternoon to talk about this problem, since now it's becoming certainly a major issue for the people.
You know, that's very nice of you to meet with Heinemann, but you know that won't achieve anything. What you're saying is that perhaps it should be a consumer's affair protection that a mobile home cannot be sold to someone unless there is a specific site where they're going to put the mobile home, if it's in a development.
Well, that's the real problem right now, is that we don't have sufficient mobile home spaces, which is why we recently introduced a mobile home program, a program to encourage the establishment of more mobile home parks.
But short of individual lawsuits by these people on perhaps what they say is oral promises, there's nothing you can do to help them.
No, there doesn't appear to be, except perhaps prod Matsqui and prod Larco and prod Consumer Affairs, but really that's where it's at. It's a matter between the developer and the people, the purchasers of the mobile homes.
Have you spoken to Larco
developers? People that have some arrangement with Larco.
Have you spoken to them yet?
I've tried to get a hold of them, but I couldn't know.
If they're watching now, can they call here and make an appointment to see you today sometime?
Over, absolutely. And certainly I'll be contacting or trying this afternoon as well.
I don't think that you people in Larco that I'm after you specifically in some way. I'm very concerned about the people that came to me. And some of them sold the houses, bought the homes for cash, acting in all naive decency and honesty, thinking we got it made. Don't you think there's a prospect, however, that perhaps the officials at Matsqui, competent though they may be, didn't keep a good enough eye on the movement of the homes into the park?
Well, of course, you can move these mobile homes in rather quickly, and I can appreciate why the mobile home seller would want to get rid of the mobile home once sold, because it gets them their money and it gets it off the lot. But I agree, there's a problem. However, we do run into this from time to time, especially if they have construction problems, and this particular site is a difficult one.
See, Snyder marked for me. They could call the ombudsman, who could use one of his 18 investigators, who would harry you, And you would say, no, you can't see these documents. Mind you, he's very quick on the big publicity ones, like Olson out in Ocala is in there like Flint. But let's try and get the Larco Developments and you together and Matsqui together, so at least the people can know that they have a government that's interested.
Well, that's what we're trying right now. And I did have an opportunity of getting the information from Matsqui, and certainly I'm looking forward now to hearing it from Larco. But the people are caught in the middle, the ones that are without a place
to go.
Especially
in the housing crisis.
Yeah.
Really, it's a shame, isn't it?
I agree, it's a shame. It certainly is.
Talking about mobile homes in general, though, are you really doing it? I fear, I know of another case where the rents in mobile homes, matter of fact, it's from Salt Spring Island, which I normally don't mention, are going up from about $90 to $100 a month, whammo, to $215 on a lease. This is what the people are told. And these are old people, and they're stuck. They can't move. They've got the concrete pads, the awnings, and everything else. Why don't you make mobile home lots available for sale so that people have a place to put it and they own it?
That has been done, and certainly it's been very successful in Surrey. And we're hoping it'll be done elsewhere. And for that reason, we've promised municipalities a $1,000 outright grant for every mobile home pad created.
For sale or for rent?
For sale or for rent. We've not distinguished between the two, and I think we need both, because not everybody wants to purchase the lot. There are still those who would prefer to rent, although I would recommend to purchase where possible. But they don't come cheap either.
No, a hell of a lot cheaper than $50,000 or $60,000 for a lot for a conventional house.
Yes, but a mobile home lot would probably run about $30,000 right now.
Okay, Larco Developments. The minister is here. You can call the switchboard. He will arrange to see you this afternoon. And I'll put you on the air to give your side of the story, too. Not trying to be unfair. Concerned about the people who've bought these mobile homes and sitting in the lot. And because of your dispute or problems with Matsqui, they can't get in. Fair deal?
Fair deal.
Back with Bill Vander Zalm and a couple of other problems for him after the break. Lillian Mann, does the name mean anything to you? Not by Burnaby, but by the archaic expropriation laws. And your report goes on to say, like Christopher Woodward's, that she's had a rough time, and the Burnaby didn't act all that sweetly. Just briefly speaking from the facts, they wanted her house for a part of a library complex, and she'd been offered $135,000, and as of this moment, she owes Burnaby legal fees and costs about $21,000. She owes $17,000 in her out-of-pocket disbursements. So if she gets $135,000 less $50,000, she'll get about, $85,000. She's at the end of the road, you know that.
Yes.
Only you can save her from disaster. What are you going to do?
Well, firstly, we did make a recommendation to Burnaby, and that recommendation is that the land be appraised, the value established on the basis of present-day zoning, that she be paid that amount of money, be permitted to continue living in the house tax-free for 5 years, and that they waive the legal fees, their end of it.
That's the $21,000.
That's right. Now, Burnaby is considering that very matter, I would guess next week. At least it wasn't on the agenda for this week, but I checked with the mayor, and I normally check about once a week.
Is that Mercer?
Mayor Mercer.
He's quitting here.
He may be. I'm not sure that that's been decided, but he's been supportive of.
So you're Mrs. leaning on, you're leaning on Burnaby to be decent and fair.
And there's still the opportunity that they might drop it. I'm not sure that they would consider this, but certainly it's one of the options available to them. And frankly,
I mean, drop the whole thing.
Drop the whole thing.
And leave her there.
And leave her there.
Meanwhile, she's stuck for appraisal costs and a legal fees. You'd have to compensate her for that if they dropped it.
She has certain costs in any case. I'm afraid she's stuck with those, and I guess Lillian Mann's aware of that.
Anyway, you are watching.
It's certainly a bad predicament, and it points out very clearly that the expropriation laws must be changed, because this goes on regularly.
The father of Bill Bennett, what
talked
was his
about
name again?
It.
WAC.
Mm-hmm.
He got a report in the early 60s from J.V. Klein. Good report.
Still around.
Catherine, the old man, NDP, and the new breed, if that's the right name, of social creditors have all done nothing.
Well, the Ministry of the Attorney General is now in the process of drawing a fair expropriation.
Do you know how many deputy ministers they've got in the Attorney General's department? Six. How many have you got in your department?
One plus the inspector.
Six deputy ministers.
Of course, there's two assistant deputies now. Whether you include those, I imagine you might.
Do you mind if we take one phone call?
No, go ahead.
Lillian Mann, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
It's about 2 years since you phoned me and I put you over at the news department, isn't it?
Correct.
Did you hear what Bill said this morning? Are you sleeping any easier because of Bill Vander Zalm's involvement?
Well, I'm not sleeping too much easier because we're still rather hanging on what Burnaby might wish to do or feel that they should do, that to try and get a commitment from Burnaby has been very, very distressing to me.
Well, in any case, if you'd got a fair price, you'd have walked away quietly in the first place.
Well, I don't think I would have, Mr. Webster. I have never fought my case on a matter of compensation. I have fought my case because I feel that my basic rights are being stolen from me and stolen from my family, and these rights did not come very easily to us.
I know, but even I would agree that our cases were expropriation for the good of the majority. If it's a proper expropriation, must be done. Isn't that right, Bill?
Well, yes, there are situations where there's no alternative. Obviously, if it's a sewer line or a road or some facility that's required by the community, an essential community, it's necessary.
Mrs. Mann, I don't want to fight the whole case again this morning. I just want to ask you a question.
Yes.
The last offer was what, $135,000?
Well, that was what the appraisal figure came in at, but the appraiser was given some very, very strict guidelines in which he had to follow.
I understand that, but I'm just looking at the situation today. $135,000, and if you were assessed their costs, it would be $20,000, right?
Well, no, my total legal fees come closer to $50,000, Mr. Webster.
I realize that. $20,000 for Burnaby, all your other out-of-pockets and your legal fees, $50,000. Well, Mr. Vander Zalm says this morning that he's suggesting what to Burnaby?
Well, we've put certain recommendations to Burnaby. One, that they drop their legal costs or charges as a charge to Mrs. Mann. Secondly, that they pay the appraised value, and this was recommended before the appraisal was done. And thirdly, that she be permitted to live in the home for 5 years, rent-free, tax-free.
Well, I just brought it to the public light for my own properties, Mrs. Mann, and for yours. And will you let me know as soon as you get a decision from Burnaby, although we'll probably hear about it through the normal channels.
Yes, I will.
Thanks, Mrs. Mann. Bye.
Thank you.
Now, before I get to the big money stuff, I see you put your foot in your mouth again.
How's that?
Surrey Alderman Gary Watkins charged that Bill Vander Zalm, serious conflict of interest, writing to the Agricultural Land Commission on behalf of two of his brothers. Now, why would you do that? On the very face of it, that's bad.
Well, they're constituents.
Oh, come off it. They're brothers.
They are constituents. They have one of two MLAs to go to. They can go to Ernie Hall, the NDP member, or they can come to me,
Willie,
their brother.
I cannot accept that.
Now, in this particular instance, they didn't come to me and ask me to write a letter. But I was so infuriated by the dumb letter that I received, frankly, I took it upon myself from the commission, Dr. Clark.
Why did they write to you?
They didn't write it to me. They wrote it to my brothers, and my brothers gave me the letter to look at. And I immediately responded to the letter. And you know, if they weren't my brothers, the story would not have appeared in the press in the first place. And if it hadn't appeared in the press, I would venture to say, there wouldn't have been a fuss. But because it appeared in the press on account of them being my brothers, the whole thing is suddenly fallen down on them. But so I feel that I have a responsibility to them, especially in that they're continually having to put up with criticisms and attacks for whatever, simply because they are a part of the family.
But that's the price of public life. You obviously don't understand.
They're not in public life. They're just out there paying their taxes, working hard, raising a family.
Sure, I know that. But if they've got a brother who's a big shot in the cabinet, the last person they should ask for help, because justice must not only be done, it must be seen to be done, is you.
I didn't ask for anything unjust. I didn't. As a matter of fact, I said to the commission as a parting shot in my letter, that if your charges on the basis of that newspaper article are found to be correct, I'll be the first to assist in assuring that things are done according to law. But there's no breach of law in this particular instance. What right is it of any government or any commission to say to anyone, be they my brothers or whomever, we must from you have a list of all of the properties you own in that area and the value of those properties? That's none of their damn business.
None of your brother's damn business, and in this regard, you should step away from that. Leave them to fight the battle.
No, they've been through the...
Okay.
They've been to lawyers. They've paid a lot of costs. The only people that are gaining by all of this is the lawyers. My brothers are losing. The taxpayers are losing. They, as taxpayers, are losing. I feel that I should stand up for them and for anyone else. If it's right, it doesn't matter who it is. Whether they're family, not family, it doesn't mean one iota.
You're wrong. With respect, deference,
and
humility, you are wrong. There's a certain delicacy needed.
I did not...
You're a man of power.
Okay,
You spend billions of dollars a year for the government. If Vander Zalm says to a government official, I want a job for my cousin, I'm just extrapolating it. People say, hey, Willie Vander Zalm, you better do what he suggests.
All right.
You know that.
Sure, I agree.
All right.
In this particular instance, I'm just answering the questions they raised.
Questions.
As an MLA on behalf of my brothers, and anyone else in the constituency, and I purposely sent copies to all of the media so there wouldn't be any questions about me doing it underhandedly.
And you just don't understand.
I understand fully.
No, you don't.
I believe in what's right, and I'll stick by it regardless of who it is.
Did the Vander Zalms, the brothers, fail to request access to King George Highway from the Highways Department?
No, they didn't. There was access already there, and the Ministry of Highways has confirmed that, and that's occurring.
Does
the
business break local bylaws, which is a very broad charge?
No, it doesn't. They got a permit to construct the greenhouse. They got a license to operate.
Are they in the land reserve without permission?
They are in the land reserve. They didn't require permission because there was already a nursery on the site when they purchased it. But before they purchased it, they went to City Hall and said, will we have any difficulties?
And you realize because of this storm in a teacup due to your lack of finesse, your lack of understanding of apparent conflict of interest, that the Ombudsman's going to hire another investigator. Watkins, your buddy, is asking the Ombudsman to investigate.
Oh, he made a motion to counsel. He couldn't even get a seconder. It was defeated. So, you know, the thing is, Watkins is raising a little political flack, and he was the NDP candidate in the last provincial election, and... obviously my brothers or anyone else couldn't go to him if that's his response.
Why couldn't the brothers have written the letter? The only reason you wrote the letter was because they'd be impressed by the clout of a cabinet minister.
No, because I thought that the Land Commission as an agency of government went much beyond anything that I see proper for government to be involved
in. All right,
you
plead guilty to an apparent conflict of interest.
No, I do not.
Well, I find you guilty.
Oh, thanks a lot.
Transpo after the break. Housing is... Chabot is the housing minister, but he's not involved in housing. Certainly not in Matsqui. You're the transport minister.
Transit.
Transit minister.
Minister in charge of transit.
But you're not in charge of transport.
Not in charge of transport.
Do we have a minister in charge of transport?
The Honorable Evan Wolfe.
Oh, what is he doing in the
provincial
cabinet?
Secretary.
Oh.
And the provincial secretary is the minister charged with transport.
I see. Now, can you give me some answers? The feds approve on your application of an Expo, Transpo 86, now Expo 86. And Clem Chapel is running what appeared to be good stories, saying that the costs of Expo 86 now have a worst loss of $300 million and that it is in danger of being scrapped. Expo 86 is in danger of going down the tube. Can you tell me if it is going?
I can't tell you if it's going down.
Could
the tube,
it go down the
but
tube?
I can assure you that it hasn't been confirmed yet.
We've
in other words, they're negotiating still, and Ottawa apparently is having a meeting this week. At least I'm told that the senators and some of the other ministers will be meeting this week. And similarly, there will be a meeting between our committee and the federal people as well in order to resolve the matter once and for all.
All right, now a figure of $60 million has been thrown about. If I can just see if I've got my little pygmy brain clear this morning. We've got BC Place, right?
Right.
We've got the stadium.
Right.
No roads to it, of course. People are going to crawl in the mud to get to it. That's the City Hall's fault, not yours. And we've got this wonderful ALRT costing how many millions of dollars?
In current dollars or as spent dollars, it'll be $650 million by 1986.
And we're buying this wonderful system of automated transport from The Ontario Crown Corporation.
That's correct.
Are we going to pay for that?
That's correct.
Did the feds promise to help you with that, or did they promise to subsidize transport so we can show this off to the world, the Ontario system?
No, the federal government had committed to be involved in Transpo with more than just a building, such
right.
as they and Alberta and Ontario and other provinces will obviously determine to put into the Transpo site. But the federal government had agreed to be more involved than just that. But those negotiations did not in part or did not at all become a part of the transit negotiations. That was a different deal.
Okay, now, are you entitled to $60 million help to buy the transit?
The federal government announced in May that they were putting up $60 million as a upfront payment towards the transit system.
Nothing to do with transit?
Well, they say now, yes, but at the time, no. And that's why their negotiations were not with my ministry or the provincial government. All of their negotiations were with the Urban Transit Authority. The transport negotiations were with government.
I understand that.
And the reason, of course, the federal government wanted to be involved in transit is because they had promised Ontario $32.8 million towards a system in Ontario and $32.8 million towards a similar system elsewhere in Canada.
That's right.
In order to promote this Canadian technology. Now, the 32 plus 32 became $60 million when the negotiations were finished. And I recall, in part, the reasons given me for the amount being less than what we initially asked for, which was $100 million, was that similarly there were other negotiations taking place with respect to transport.
Ah, that's the point. So what you're looking for, and you're strapped for money this year, you want commitment for Expo 70, what is it?
86.
86. And you certainly want your $60 million. You want it now for this ALRT, or will you take it down the road?
Well, we had thought up front meant right away. As a
yeah.
matter of fact, we believed we were going to get the money in 30 days. We understood certain negotiations had to take place, like how do we give the federal government recognition for their contribution? Do we put a decal on the train? Do we say on the side of the train, federal government participation, or how do we do it? Those negotiations did carry on all through the summer, but they finally agreed as to how this could best be done.
Little side of the train?
There'll be an option. Well, they'll in fact purchase 50% of the trains and get their little signs, and they'll also purchase a portion of the pre-built section, which goes from BC Place to about Commercial on Terminal.
But no more than $60 million worth.
But no more than $60 million.
Okay, now you'll confuse me if you go into all your bureaucratic okay. nonsense. I have a certain sympathy with you. If this were in Ontario or Quebec, that was an expo. It's a second-class expo, isn't it? Second-class world fair, right?
Right.
There'd be no argument at all.
Well, they had one in
I hate to
Montreal.
Sound like a social
no.
creditor, but I strongly
no,
suspect...
you're sounding like a British Columbian, and that appears to be the reality of life too often, unfortunately.
If this was in Ontario or Quebec, they'd have had the money up front and be well on the way.
It happened in Montreal. They contributed considerably towards Expo there, and we're similarly asking for
now
a like deal in
we'll
in
come
British
to
Columbia.
The depressing, but what seems to me authoritative information from Clam Chapel. The original estimate for Expo was a $12 million loss. And now with financing, it looks like a $300 million.
Well, things have changed from when the program was first yeah. proposed in that when they established the Transpo site as a part of the overall BC Place location, certain negotiations took place following that with the city, and they decided to put houses or housing in a portion of what it was initially to be Transpo.
That's so hardcore again.
So they shifted Transpo further east, which meant they got into lands that are presently leased, and some of the lands that are owned by the city. And that has boosted the cost because we now need to purchase those leases.
Okay.
But we're not looking at any, I don't know where those figures have come from.
But don't confuse
I agree it's gone up from $12 million, and I certainly heard you mention a figure of $60 million, and I suppose we're not too far out when you talk figures like that. But where the 100 or 200 or 300 million came from, I can't say. I've not heard that figure.
So right now, we're sitting here. You haven't got your upfront money yet on the ALRT.
I was told yesterday by Mr. Lumley that Our understanding, he's the Minister of Trade and Commerce in Ottawa. Mm-hmm. And I was told yesterday that our understanding for upfront differs from their understanding in that they say upfront could be any time within this fiscal year, which ends March 31st, 1982. My understanding of upfront was, you know, we're now purchasing right away, we're engineering, we're soil testing, now is when we need some of that money.
I know that your government has stopped this big financial boast a year ago saying if they cop out, we'll go it alone, no?
No.
Because you're tight for money.
I've not said that. No, I
think Bennett said it.
No, I've not heard this. And frankly, I don't think there's any backing out of transit. I was in the lineups this morning. I almost didn't make it here. We've got to have transit in the Lower Mainland.
Question.
And if the federal government backs off, we still need transit.
I thought the same. You'll still pay for it.
We'll pay for it.
Okay. Just one question. When will we actually get a decision if Transpo 86 is going ahead or not?
I imagine within the next week or two.
And the ALI.
It's got to be then, because certainly the building must proceed
soon.
Oh,
by the way, Dale Hicks, BCTV news guy, says that the designers of Calgary's system predict your automated system will collapse within 3 years.
Well, the same designers of the Calgary system obviously didn't expect what happened there. They had their difficulties at first
as well.
With drivers. And they've still got difficulties in that there's an awful lot of people in Calgary that must still drive their car that are terribly upset with all of the level crossings, the gates coming down, the bells ringing, the lights flashing.
Looks like something out of Europe 1910.
I like our system.
Driverless,
preferably.
Sit at the back of the car.
Okay, I think it's the safest.
Find you guilty and conflict of interest. You promised action on the mobile homes. What else have I learned from you? Not very much.
Well, there's lots to do in the Ministry of Municipal Affairs. If you want to know about further programs, what we're doing to the Municipal Act, okay. I'd be pleased to spend the rest of the morning.
You mean the Municipal Act?
The Municipal Act.
Not the Municipal Act. The Municipal Act.
Municipal.
Municipal.
You've been
here long enough.
Scottish accent, I've got a Dutch accent.
You've been here long enough to be able to speak the language.
But the Dutch learn quicker.
Municipal. I tried to get Harry de Jong, this prominent Canadian Dutchman, on the end about Matsqui, but no. Didn't want to talk.
Too bad.
Too bad. But you'll jack them up, won't you?
Yeah, well, I'll certainly follow through on the Matsqui deal. You can be sure of that.
Okay. On Lillian Mann. Calls to Willie Vander Zalm. I wouldn't call him Willie Wooden Shoes. It's a racist insult. Willie Vander Zalm. After the break. Here's the man who's going to give his automated driverless rapid transit. You know what he wants to do with municipal voting, or municipal voting? He wants to go back to 1890, the old Tammany Hall system, where you have a poll book and you go in and say, here's my driver's license, I'm going to vote. You're joking.
No, that's for real.
No enumeration.
Well, now, wait a minute.
Anybody can
there's
vote.
There's really no the enumeration now. What they do in the municipality at present is they have booths throughout their municipality where people can register for a period of 2 to 3 weeks. And they put on a bit of an advertising blitz. In total, municipalities spend perhaps $1 million annually to try and update their voters' lists. And it's a list for Surrey about so thick. And I can recall sitting on council, and once a year there's a quarter revision, and the council members are then supposed to check the list to make sure of its accuracy. There's a stamp put on, people sign it, the chairman signs it, it's nothing at all, which is why oftentimes you'll find people on the list that no longer live there or people on the list that are 10 years dead. What I'm saying instead, why spend $1 million? Why have this archaic system? Because even if you're not on the list, you can go into the municipal voting or election, declare your eligibility, and put the vote in an envelope.
I get your point, but just one thing. I thought this was 1981.
All right, people will go in, they'll sign a declaration, they'll provide the ID, and the declaration may have to say, if it's a false declaration, it's $5,000 or 2 years in jail or something like that. Perhaps that'll be one of the remedies, but it'll certainly be more effective.
Mind you, we're not really a nation at the moment, but surely to God, that you could have a master voters list for most of the people in the country and punch it up for federal, provincial, municipal.
Well, the eligibility is different for, of course, a municipal election from what it is in a provincial election, or even for a federal election because of age.
Willie, I'm getting bored with that.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Vander Zalm.
Yes, sir.
Rapid transit is going to be fully automated, unlike Calgary, with anybody running it?
Well, of course, it won't be entirely my decision, but if I have my way, yes, that's how I'd like to see it.
I live in the Central Park area, and it's going to be very convenient for me. And if it's automated, I will not be riding on it.
Well, you'll have an opportunity of seeing how an automated system works, because in 1983, we'll have the test track on Terminal Avenue, and that'll give you an opportunity to see how well it works and how much safer it is.
I saw it in San Francisco, and I don't like it at all.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Hello.
I would like to speak to Bill, please.
Now, look, let's get this quite clear. You don't have to come on and say you'd like to speak to Bill. When I say go ahead, talk to him. Go ahead.
Now, Jack, don't get angry. I wanted to say that this has nothing to do with municipal affairs. That I just wanted to satisfy my curiosity as to whether my memory is good or not. Bill, did you migrate to Canada in the early 40s?
Late 40s.
Thank you, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
Gentlemen, good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Have you read the Ombudsman's bestseller, Dangerous Precedent? Anyone needing a copy, you could identify it by the Ombudsman's title, Public Report Number 3, The Cuthbert Case.
The Cuthbert Case, yes. You mean the expropriation case down in Roberts Bank.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Mr. Vander Zalm, you promised to reply to my request help stop this expropriation and get my title returned.
This is the owner.
Mm-hmm.
Am I to believe?
My sympathies are with Mr. Cuthbert, and certainly it's not necessarily because I have all of the details of the case or can compare it to what happened at the time, but I just don't know whether the government, I don't believe the government needs any more land in that area if in fact all we're going to do with it is simply make it a part of the agricultural
reserve. Have you answered his letter? Did he answer
yes.
your letter?
He has not yet answered my letter. He intends to answer me again after he had read the report.
Yes.
Will you do that, Mr. Vander Zalm?
Well, the report has been referred to committee, and I agree it's been hanging about for a time, but it's still with the Ministry of Transport, and I hope that we'll get action on it.
Thank you for nagging him. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. What I'd like to talk about is the abuse of authority by civil servants in a municipal hall. It's not the law so much, but the abuse of authority. Now, when a civil servant has a disagreement with you, you have to get a lawyer and you have to go to a lot of expenses. And even when you win, as the man did in West Vancouver, the civil servant doesn't get fired. It doesn't cost him a nickel. The taxpayer pays the bill and he's still got his job. I think the lawyer should be paid both sides by the municipal hall, same as when you're fighting your own union. The lawyer for both sides should be paid. Otherwise, the civil servant, he can be real authoritarian with you and abuse of authority, and it doesn't cost him a nickel. He doesn't lose his job, doesn't cost him a bean. Even when he's found wrong, he's in the clear.
He's right. Yeah, he's absolutely right, which is why in the Planning Act, where we provide for the first time some means, however limited, of appeal, we are saying that the inspector or his appointees can award the cost to either party. And if someone is appealing without having any reason for appeal, then he may pay all of the cost, including municipal, and quite the other way around if, in fact, there is some evidence that there is a case.
This is only a white paper on the Planning Act, isn't it?
It's hopefully legislation come fall.
Good
but
point, sir. Thank
right.
you. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, gentlemen. I thought you might like some up-to-date facts on some of the mobile home situations. I live in a park where the rent is going not from 100 to 200, but from 200 and some to 300 and some dollars a month. This is going to put many of the senior citizens in this park in a very difficult position, as it's way beyond their means. Also, I checked out prices exactly a year ago today to buy a mobile home lot. It was not $30,000, it was $70,000. When you consider that twice as many mobile home lots are allowed per acre as housing lots, I think somebody is really skimming the public.
$70,000.
That's right.
Where?
Langley.
For
Well, it depends, Jack, on the firstly, if I agree that if there's a limited supply, then you may pay more than what you would otherwise if there were proper competition in the system. But again, mobile home parks will vary. I mean, not only the quality of pad and the landscaping within the area, but there could be certain facilities available to the people there that we're not aware of. like a recreation hall or a swimming pool or the likes
of
this.
But wasn't it in Surrey where I think they offered public land for sale as mobile home lots at specific prices?
They were offered for sale about 6-7 years ago for $25,000, I believe the price. They're now up to perhaps closer to $35,000 or $40,000, I'm not
sure.
By
the municipality?
By the municipality.
Yeah, so therefore that's the only way to get reasonably priced land to people on mobile homes.
Yeah, now, you know, the problem that we're facing throughout British Columbia, I guess throughout Canada, with the tremendous rent escalations is largely due to the interest rates because mortgages are being renewed. You know, the only way we can come at that, it's not the only way, but it's my suggestion, is that people putting money into mortgages should be allowed a tax exemption for those mortgages if they put it in at half the prime rate.
Is it now the time,
you'd have lots
Bill Vander Zalm, because you're one of the people that blamed the NDP for the rapid upsurge in lot costs, to scrap the agricultural land reserve and let the market take care of its own?
No, but there's lots of land that is going to come out in the next 5 or 10 or 15 years because it's obviously not agricultural land, and I would much prefer to see it come out now so there's plenty of competition in the marketplace.
Providing you don't hammer the developers for God knows how many thousand dollars for pre-development of the lot.
Well, that's a problem. The development cost charges could get out of whack. On the other hand, I suppose there needs to be some protection for the present-day resident. He can't be stuck with the cost for the newcomer.
An awful lot of old people would be quite happy, said he, and they're not being snarky, with a gravel road, the overhead lights, the simplest possible arrangement, if it kept the price of a lot down, which they could buy for the declining years, to something reasonable.
Well, having been in municipal politics for some time, I don't think it takes too long before the people petition you to have the road blacktopped and sidewalk put in and the street lights installed.
Your politicians
so
can't
win. We're accustomed to a fairly high standard. I guess we're certainly a spoiled people.
Well,
I
you
suppose
politicians
that's why
can't win anymore, can you?
It's tough to be in politics.
When are you going to quit?
It's not easy. Well, not just yet.
Still get your eyes in being premier, haven't you?
No, not really.
Not really.
Not really.
Willie resigns and there's a little draft.
Well, hey, if that should occur, I suppose
you'd go for broke.
Well, we would have to assess if you would put your name forth. I'd bow out, but you know, you'd have to assess who's going to be available.
If I ever did, I would never be in apparent conflict of interest with my family.
Where's your family?
Kamloops.
Oh, I
Victoria,
thought it was Glasgow.
Vancouver.
Well, if they were in your constituency, I'd expect you to stand up for them.
I wouldn't do it because it wouldn't look good.
Well, never mind the looks. It's what's right that matters.
Well, you don't
If
understand.
It's all looks and politics, you don't get things done fairly.
My thanks to Bill Vander Zalm, Minister of Municipal Affairs. Extrovert extraordinaire, another French word, of the Social Credit Government. Now somebody's going to get fired after the break.
Yes, sir.
Yes. This is like the CDC. It's so
30 seconds.
I think it's self-evident that Canadian business is filled with people who have followed the Peter Principle to a level above their competence, and they have to get fired sometimes. NFB has a new film produced by this and that, we'll tell you about later, called After the Axe. Here's what happens when somebody now gets chopped.
Trust me, Mr. Wilson, I know what I'm doing.
Eric Barton, the consultant hired to orchestrate the termination, met with Wilson moments after it took place, just as planned.
For security reasons and company policy, it will be appropriate for you to give to either me or Mr. Anderson down the hall, the director of personnel, your keys and any credit cards that you may have.
Well, an hour later.
Well, it doesn't matter. If it's convenient for you, I'll be happy to take them. I'm sorry to have to ask for them, but I might just suggest to you that it's very much in your interest to leave the company this afternoon in a very professional manner.
Come on, that's all right, it's all right. I know how to behave myself.
Okay, well, look, it's most important. It may not appear so right now, but later on I'd be happy to explain why. I have a lot of experience in these matters, and I've seen a number of people do things that could seriously jeopardize their job search activities.
That's right, I understand.
The hatchet man in that little clip from the NFB film After the Axe, an hour-long fictionalized documentary, is now in the studio with me. Eric Barton, head of relocation services for Thorne, Stevenson and Kellogg, right? And you're the hatchet man. Are you brought in, taking it into real life, to review the standards of management, you decide who will be fired, and then you come in as a smooth PR guy to shuffle the poor fellow on his way.
No.
Who are you in this picture?
I'm called in when the company or organization, it isn't business by itself either, Jack. It's government, it's nonprofit organizations, churches, and whatever. Whenever an organization decides to terminate the services of an individual, and I help them plan the effective release of that individual, taking into consideration their background and the kind of person they are, and then I meet the individual right afterwards, but I have nothing to do with the specific dismissal conversation.
You don't come in and say you're fired?
No, I have nothing to do with that.
The company says, we've got new plans for you. We're taking away your carpet, and we're putting it back down to one form with no buttons on it.
No, the person's out. And in most cases, in the United States and Canada, I'd say that of the over 1,000 dismissals in Canada that I've participated in, probably 80% of them are what we call fast fire, which is what you saw on the film clip there. The part of that film clip which wasn't quite accurate is that normally we spend anywhere from 1 to 5 hours with the candidate right after they have been terminated.
And only the big companies can afford to hire the likes of you to get relocation services for the middle management guy who's being chopped.
No. Churches do it, and we do it half price.
Do it half price for churches?
Certainly.
You don't do it half price for business?
No, I wouldn't.
Now, what do you do then?
Well, I then work with the individual for, on an average, up to 4.5 months, and we put them through a medical examination, psychological evaluation.
Is he still on the payroll of the company?
Sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
He's always granted a severance in accordance with the law of that jurisdiction. And we provide office services and counseling and strategic planning and career goal setting on average for 4.5 months for the individual until they have secured a new job.
Do you help them to get the new job? Do you guide them to the new job?
Absolutely. Day and night.
So that's of the 1,000. You mentioned 1,000. Was that over a year?
No. We do about 400 in Toronto, and we have offices now in Montreal, Winnipeg, Calgary, Edmonton, and Vancouver.
And what would be the total in 1 year?
I would say probably in total we probably do 500.
500. Now, what percentage of them are not sufficiently shattered that they aren't able to pick up a new career?
Over 95% of them, Jack, use our services right through to the expiry of the arrangement, which is until they have a new job. Statistically, over 65% of them, for people over the age of 40, look very seriously at new careers. And in fact, over 40% of them will change the function that they are in if they're over the age of 40, and 18 to 20% will change their career directly.
This is where you come in, because you'll use, or your people will use the expertise to guide them to a new career.
That's correct.
All right. Counsel me. I've just been fired. I'm 63.
You have a lifetime ahead of you.
No, just a minute. Don't give me that PR nonsense. I'm 63. I've just been fired. I've made reasonably good money. I've got a very poor private pension plan, as many private industries have poor pension plans. How can you counsel me? I'm desperate now.
Okay.
I'm finished.
All right. Let's. The issues that would face you, if you were in an organization today and you were fired after a number of years, people don't think that far in advance the minute they're fired, because they don't know when they're going to get fired. They may have an idea that it's going to happen, but they never know when. So they're always in a state of shock. They're dysfunctional at that point in time. And
dysfunctional? What does that mean?
Well, they're not in complete control of their emotions.
They're shattered.
That's right. And
my wife's nagging them. I told you you were going to get fired.
Your wife isn't in the picture yet. You've just been fired.
Oh, so got to go home and tell her.
That's right. Oh, so that's one thing we got to talk about.
So go for a drink right away.
No, maybe, if that's what you want to do. Mm-hmm. But we've got to orchestrate how you leave the organization so that you don't bop somebody in the nose, and you might.
At 63, I might as well.
You might.
No, I mean, you're not going to waste your time counseling some 63-year-old semi-skilled guy who's been in a cushy job, as I've been for 25 years. Never saved a nickel.
As a matter of fact, I don't know that we have worked with somebody as old as you, but we have worked with 62-year-olds. And Jack, they all get good jobs.
How old are you?
I'm 43.
Do you feel secure?
Very, very.
Stevenson and Kellogg.
I do.
Now, but just a minute. So therefore, this only applies to people between certain effective age groups.
No, our group has been between the ages of 25 and 62.
Mm-hmm. Mind you, the first thing that the average guy does nowadays is sue his firm, issues a writ, because you get very generous settlements nowadays in British Columbia.
No, he doesn't.
On the slightest excuses.
The average guy doesn't do that.
Well, I know a couple, especially civil servants.
Yeah, some do, but not the average.
I remember one that walked away recently, nobody would tell us a figure, it was $100,000.
Well,
just
sure.
Because he threatened to make a fuss.
That's right.
If you've got a little blackmail in you, you can do better, can't you?
No, one of the roles that we play, and this is quite serious, is that many senior executives, the first thing they think about is to issue a writ against their employer.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And the critical thing, Jack, is that what you see in the movies and in the cinema and in the press is what happens to those people when they win. What you don't see are the people who lose. And in the fourth month, when they can't get a hold of their lawyer, their cash is cut off, they can't get a mortgage, they can't get money out of the bank, and their spouse is jumping all over them, they're spending 80% of their time concentrating on their lawsuit, and he's on holidays. You should see those people.
Yeah, you're at least useful for keeping lawsuits off the backs of the companies.
I work very hard to prevent that.
But you get people a fair deal on severance.
And doggone right I do.
All right, if I'm making $35,000 a year and I've been there 10 years, and I'm 48 years of age and I've been in charge of a department, how much severance will I get?
Well,
on a fair basis.
But could you go over the numbers again?
38,000. What there, 15 years. Good and faithful, but dull, plodding servant, and beginning to slip because I'm getting old. How much will I get in the way of severance? 15 years.
Somewhere between 9 and 12 months.
That's not bad.
Plus us.
Oh, you're free.
No, I'm not free.
No, but you're free to the...
Individual.
Guy has been asked.
That's correct.
You're quite bright. Are you an accountant?
No, I'm not.
What are you?
I'm a businessman.
Psychologist.
I have sociology in my background.
Learned along the way. You from Toronto?
Yes.
Oh, I can't help that. After the break. This guy's name is Stipla Gunnarsson. And the last time I saw you, you were sitting in the back here editing ENG stuff for this program.
That's right.
What are you doing here this morning?
Well, I'm here promoting the film. I left BC TV, went to Toronto, was unemployed for 7 months until I got this off the ground.
And you and a fella called?
Steve Lucas.
Who went to school with my son.
That's right.
Jack, raised the money to produce this film.
That's right.
Where did you get it?
We packaged the idea, sold it to the film board. And
great stuff. How much?
$250,000.
$250,000. And that's how long ago you left here? 7 months?
Oh, no. No, I left here over 2 years ago.
More than 2 years ago?
Yeah.
How time flies. So you're the producer?
That's right, and director.
Where did you get the idea?
Well, I was unemployed for starters. Steve had just been fired, so that was a pretty good starting point. We heard about a place where unemployed executives went every morning, kissed their spouses goodbye, and put on a suit and tie, walked in, and made like they were still working. Seemed interesting.
Where was that?
Well, that, as it turns out, was a place called 40 Plus, which is a self-help club.
Where?
In Toronto.
In Toronto. Is this part of your organization,
no.
Mr. Barton?
No. No, it's a different organization providing the same kind of services in a different field.
Yeah, and so from this idea, you got the idea to make a documentary.
That's right.
Raised $250,000, went out and made it.
That's right.
Quite a success story, isn't it?
Yes.
Everybody, all the key people on the film are Vancouverites. The art director, Judy Kunar, the editor, Roger Matusi, Steve, Lucas, Andy Polson, were all people who left Vancouver, went out east, and
created your own job.
That's right.
How long does the movie run? An hour, isn't it?
An hour, yes.
Well, now, what do you expect to grow from this? What do you expect to develop from the movie? Are you merely broadly disseminating the principles of handling a thing like this?
You asking him or me?
Either of you.
Well, I see it as a social documentary. A lot of people see the film, and they have a very violent reaction to Eric and what he's promoting. What we're more interested in dealing with in the film is the kind of values we have in our society today. Why are we so wound up in our work?
Stella, you and all these people who talk about values leave me cold. What does he mean, the kind of values? You want to make a living, to look after your family and prepare for your pension and your regrave, don't you?
What he's talking about, and I think it's right, and people, when they watch the film, they get very upset about a whole lot of different issues. I think one of the issues is that if you are in an organization, you can get fired, and being fired is a traumatic experience.
Unless you're a union member, of course, that's different.
Yes, I'm talking white collar and management. Mm-hmm. So there's a very strong growing theory in the United States today about the Japanese business culture and organization life that maybe we should be orienting ourselves more that way. Where an individual joins a family kind of company and the threat of dismissal is obsolete.
Oh, no.
No?
We don't want that kind of thing, do we?
Well, I don't know.
Where you're part of the loving family of the eternal emperor at the top of the pyramid in the company.
Well, I think some people might like that, Jack, and would prefer
well,
that.
Well, they become civil servants in Canada, don't they, these people?
The governments are using our services.
Yeah, but civil servants, don't they have a general attitude that they're there forever and they're part of the loving family and can't be fired?
And it's very, very tough to work with them after they have been, believe me, because it takes at least 2 to 3 months longer to get them through the culture of what it's like to be working in a profit-oriented environment again. And if they've been there for 20, 25 years, it's very, very hard.
If you're counseling a civil servant who's been shuffled out, well, they just put him in another department.
I beg your pardon?
They just put him in another department.
For a while.
And you've successfully counseled ex-civil servants to go out into private industry?
Yes, I think the most successful thing we've done is that we have gotten the some provincial governments and the federal government to be very aware of what happens to people by shuffling them around from department to department. It's demoralizing and it's dehumanizing to those people. They have a right to be...
treated decently.
That's right, to be challenged and to be productive in Canada, and they can be if they're properly counseled.
Have you ever gone in to give your services to a middle management executive, take one look at the guy and said, there's nothing I can do for this
fellow? No. Jack, we're going way beyond the business environment now. We're going into sports.
Sports?
Of course.
Guy's a cripple, he can't play anymore.
No. He's 28 years old, and the average age in the NHL is dropping every year, and he's making $250,000 a year. He hasn't done anything but lace up his skates since he's 15. What does he do?
Do we have to tell them to go hire a lawyer and an advisor?
Doesn't need a lawyer, but he may need me.
Well, you'll sell your services to him.
Yes, I'll try.
You looking for business now? We've got a couple of guys who won't make it on the Canucks. Saw them last night.
All right. In addition, Jack, may I just suggest to you that we're also working with the John Howard Society in Collins Bay in Kingston to do work with white-collar criminals coming out.
Oh, my God. Here we go again. More rehabilitation coming out
of here.
Of
course. That's right.
Are you going to become a government department?
No. No way.
Everybody's got to be fed and watered and catered to and primped and looked after?
No, but if you take a look at the whole human resources spectrum in this country, there are consultants and practices in labor and compensation and recruitment and evaluation, organization development. And the one area that there wasn't anything until 5.5 years ago is what are we going to do when we dispense with the services of a human being? And that's what we jumped on, and that's the whole.
I tell you what, I'll give you a job right now to reorganize the human resources all across the country. You know, the welfare departments, you might do a lot better. You might give them some incentive and some
challenge. It would be a challenge.
Drives you crazy.
Yes.
Give my regards to Steve Lucas.
Okay.
Hope your film, After the Axe, is a grand success. I hope I never need your services, and if I did, I wouldn't ask you. But I realize it's a valid, useful, decent, sympathetic, effective way to deal with people who have lost their place as a cog in one machine or another. Dear old Mike Cramond is going to come on here and shoot me through the forehead, pretending I'm a grizzly bear. After the break. Let's relax with an old friend of mine, Mike Cramond, who's got a bestseller on the go in the States and here, and it's called Killer Bears. Well, I know you're the outdoor expert, Mike, but can I tell you a little story?
I'd love to hear it, Jack.
When the kids were very young, we drove up Barrier, Clearwater, went into that park where Helmickan Falls is.
Yes.
Three young kids, a convertible car, a tent, and me, and my wife. We were surrounded by bears the whole night. We were the only people in the camp, and I was absolutely terrified. As soon as it was light, we got into the car and escaped. Can that still happen in BC?
Oh, yes. It can happen anywhere in B.C., particularly where they have garbage dumps in connection with parks.
They got one up at Harrison.
Yes, they have them in practically every park area in B.C.
Now, we see the gruesome stories, and you've got some beautiful gruesome stories in here about people being attacked and killed all over North America, as a matter of fact, by grizzlies.
Yeah.
Is this or Alberta or some of the American states the most dangerous place to camp without preparation?
Jack, there isn't really any preparation that you can make against attack by a bear because it is so, there's nothing that really gives you any idea that's going to happen. If there was anything that you could do, we wouldn't have these statistics what you're looking at right now.
They're frightening statistics.
They are in the sense of the numbers of people that are killed, but when you put them in relation to the number of visitations there are in these areas, they are minimal. And in that sense, I had occasion driving through Montana to notice by the roadway there were little white crosses. And when I got further down in, I said, what are these little white crosses on the highway? And they said, oh, those were places where people have been killed. And in one of these corners, there had been five of these crosses put up. Well, when I was in Yellowstone Park doing research in reference to these statistics, it occurred to me that five people had been killed in that one little spot on the highway, yet in all the period of time that Yellowstone had been open, there'd only been five deaths, and there were multi-million visitors through. So you have to take it by comparison to the number of people that visit an area.
Well, just let me go through, and this fascinates me. Kills by black bears in the wild. Fortune James, Fitching, you don't know what happened. Caslow, B.C., Nelson, B.C., and attacks by grizzlies in the wild. Fort Nelson, B.C., 100 Mile House, B.C., Mica Creek, Grey Creek. British Columbia figures very prominently in all these serious attacks. And then we come to the grizzly kills. Now, the worst grizzly kills were where these two girls were devoured by the bears in the sleeping bags. Was that in Montana?
I think you're referring to the ones in Glacier National Park.
Right,
there were
right.
two that were killed within one night, but they were 15 miles apart. There was absolutely no connection. That was just one of those coincidences that you can't believe can happen. But there were two were killed, and sleeping bag incidents are quite common. And this is when you said that you felt frightened in the park at the North Thompson there. I know exactly how you feel, because I traveled just as you did much of my life with my youngsters and wife. We slept in a tent, but I always had a shotgun beside me. And this gave me at least a feeling that if anything does occur, I do have a shotgun to frighten them off.
Frighten them off or kill them?
I would kill them if they were close. I've shot over their heads. I don't want to ever kill a bear unless I have to. It's as simple as that.
And a shotgun is the weapon of choice.
At close range, by all means, yes.
How close?
Well, from 10 to 30 feet. Let's put it in that terms.
The stories are great, but there isn't really a message in your book except an intriguing adventure story and the fact to be damn careful about bears in the wild.
Well, the message is basically to get over to people that you can't walk with immunity in wild areas if you don't take some precaution. But even though you take all precautions, the chances are that if the bear decides it wants you, it's going to take you. And there isn't very much you can do about it. And a cardinal, as an example, was actively stalking a grizzly in the snow, following its track. The bear went around a little hummock of moss and came out behind him. The man had his rifle in his hand, and it killed him. He never even got his gloves off to shoot it.
Cardinal, who was he?
He was a trapper in northern B.C. And this is an example of how quick it happens. I don't look like it, I presume, but particularly the way your girl so nicely made me up, but I've lived a tough life in the bush as well as many others. But I turned around because of the chap who was sitting in front of me. The look on his face was unbelievable. And I turned around, and right behind me, 15, 20 feet away, was a black bear in full charge. And I happened to have my gun in my hand, and when I shot it, it threw blood on me, on my face and pants. Now, I'm a hunter, and I'm supposed to be prepared, and I could have been a statistic just like the rest of them there.
A black bear?
A black bear, yes.
Only, maybe 250, 400 pounds?
Not any more than 250 pounds.
Running at you or standing up?
No, it was coming straight on all fours, and I, as long as I live, I'll never forget the ruby-like, you know, the bloodshot eyes and the mouth, and you know, it's one of those things you can't believe. I see it. I don't worry about it, but I see it today.
Shotgun up, and he went down.
No, I had a 32-20 rifle, and I hit him four times, and the first shot, to show you how close it was, the first shot, I didn't even get my gun up. The first shot hit it in the paw, and that's what threw the blood on my face and pants.
You dodged, he passed.
No, She stopped. It was a sow bear. She stopped and threw her paw around like that. As I say, that's what threw the blood on me. And then I fired two more shots into her while she was that close, about 6 feet away, actually. And then one, as she turned, I hit her in the rear as she went through the bush.
Might take some calls on this, and I want to ask you, you've got some good questions in the cover here. Can a strong man fight off an adult bear?
He can't actually even begin to fight it off, but he can deter the death.
If attacked, should you fight or play dead?
Well, the statistics show that those who fought have better chance of survival than those who played dead.
More with Mike Cramond, and if you have any good sharp bear stories, remember the woman we had on from Dawson? Oh, that's another story. After the break. Mike Cramond. I wish I had more time for Mike, for killer bears. Walk backwards as fast as you can.
I was just telling you that about one instance where I had photographed a black bear, and I saw that later, about 3 miles on further, I saw another bear go into the bush, and when I got up to the area, I started in after it, and it was a grizzly. Well, I tell you, you can walk backwards very quickly, too.
Where was this, up in Anaheim Lake or somewhere west of the mountains?
This is just north of Squamish in the Mount Currie area.
I thought we only had a few grizzlies in very isolated regions up beyond Bella Coola way.
No, Bella Coola in the book is designated as the grizzly, killer grizzly capital of the world because more incidents have happened up there than anywhere else. And some extremely interesting things that you find out, and yet, as an example, in that same area in Bella Bella, the game warden up there was telling me about a woman that was complaining that a grizzly, which they were camped on the side of the river, and she called the game warden, asked him to come up. He came up, and the grizzly walked through the camp and out, and she said, "I wish you'd get that bear out of here. The children fed it its lunches, their lunches yesterday, and it's still bothering us."
Grizzly bear?
Grizzly bear.
Are they predictable at all? I mean, if you, in normal circumstances, if a bear approaches you, what should you do? You're stuck there, you're having a picnic.
The best thing to do is stand still. Hold your ground if you can, and hold your water if you can, but this is the basis that fear is a part of all of us. If you say you haven't got it, it's because you haven't got any brains, but if you have enough ability to withstand that fear, stand there, and if you can, back up. But not before it starts, it indicates it's going to move.
Get into the car and leave if you can.
Get out of there.
Get out of there. Leave everything.
That's right.
Get the hell out.
Doesn't matter what you've left there. You got your own skin. Take that with you.
Especially your kids.
Yes, first.
Brown bears are harmless.
No, there's no such thing as a brown bear, actually, Jack. A brown is a phase of both grizzly and black bear.
Jesus, been living in a fool's paradise for me see all these years.
Well, brown bear, there's a brown grizzly, or a brown bear of the north.
Mike, we should have had more time, but let's make your call short and sharp and to the point, please. Go ahead.
Yeah, as a guide, I've had quite a few experiences with bears, and I've had them come into my tent, and I just don't think bears are, I just don't think they're as dangerous as people say, you know.
Okay, like, here's Mike on that topic.
You keep thinking that way. The Lord has been with you.
Go ahead from Williams Lake.
Oh, my husband was out hunting with a partner a couple of weeks ago, and they were on a road, and they'd stood on the road and talked about which way they were going to turn, and they decided to separate and head off the road in either direction, and there was sort of a field. And he took about 10 steps off the road, and this bear charged him, and he had to shoot it. And the unfortunate thing was there were three cubs, and he treed the cubs, and we got forestry out, and they had to shoot the cubs.
Normal situation?
It's a quite normal situation, but often they will attempt to do something with the cubs rather than shoot them.
Thank you, ma'am.
Depending on their age.
Go ahead, please, to Mike Cramond, author of Killer Bears.
Yeah, I'd like to make a point here. I don't know if he makes a point in his book or not, but it's concerning grizzlies. That when you're hunting them, I've heard stories, like I do a lot of hunting up Dee's Lake up in there. I've guided up there a little bit. And that once a grizzly starts charging at you, the adrenaline builds up so much that you can fire, I don't care how many shots you want, into that bear, that something just does not want to make it drop.
Have you done that?
Hey, pardon?
Have you done that?
I haven't been, you know, I've been lucky. You know.
Okay, how about that?
Well, the Dee's Lake area that he's speaking of, Jack, I know because I've had the circumstance that he spoke of actually happened to me, where I had put what I had into a bear and it still came, and the Indian guide, thank God, killed it. Now, in that case, it was one of those situations that I was filming it and had no intention of killing it, but it happened. But the adrenaline builds up in any circumstance, but the question is whether or not you make a killing shot.
Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I've had several encounters with bears. First, when I was about 9 years old, I've been treed by a black bear before. But the one story that I did want to tell you about was something that I read about 6 months ago in a reliable magazine of a fellow who decided that he didn't need to be armed with anything other than a 35-millimeter camera while walking through the wilds. And what ended up happening to him was they found the camera, and he had been taking pictures of a grizzly bear. And the last picture on the roll of film that he had taken was of the bear biting into his leg. Now, this is a fellow who's decided, well, I don't believe in guns, so as long as I don't have a gun, the bears won't bother me.
Advice for that situation, Mike Cramond.
Don't listen to such stupidity. A bear, if it decides to come after you, the gun is the only deterrent that you actually have in the way of killing it. Hopefully we might, I have at the present time discussing with one scientist the possibility of using mace or something of that nature that would deter it. I don't know whether it's a feasible thing, but a gun is the only way that you can actually be sure. And you can't be sure then.
No doubt in my mind about it. Where are we going? Squamish. Grizzly bear country, Squamish.
Hello. Yeah. Yes, there are bears up here, and we've had about 13 or so killed this last summer. The garbage dump was moved to near the airport here, which is a fine place. Good for birds anyway, but not for planes. But anyway, we had these bears killed. Now, I don't feel they should be killed. I feel they should be tranquilized and removed.
Okay, short, sharp answer from Mike on that one.
I think it's an excellent idea to tranquilize them and remove them, but you can almost be assured that within 3 days the bear will be back. They've been moved as much as 100 miles and been back in 3 days.
They did that at Churchill with the polar bears.
That's right.
And they trotted back 500 miles across the ice to get more garbage.
That's right.
Well,
this is a common trait. Once they're accustomed to feeding on garbage, they'll come back. And I feel with you. Bear, if you can save it, yes. I would hope that there was some way to get them into the zoos of the world.
This is a good book, BC book. Excuse me, witness. Mike, very best of luck.
Thank you, Jack.
Nice to see you. Stay clear of bears.
Thank you. Will you? Will do.
Carry a shotgun at all times.
Thank you.
I'll be back after the break. Before I forget, the free showing of that after the acts at the Media Center in Vancouver, Robson Square, tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. Jay Kemp's going to be here tomorrow. He's the bright Tory on the Constitution, although I hate to talk about it, but we'll have to face up the facts of life. And Addie Emmer's going to come in and scream at me. Should be a bright morning. Hope it's as bright as this morning's was. 9 a.m. precisely.